Hey folks, got a little update on the 48-inch ILG. I have cleaned up the mud dauber and wasp nest and put a fresh coating of varnish onto the winding, and it's looking good. Getting it ready to go back together. What my plan is to get the motor internals done and then put it together and then paint the outside of it. So the motor itself, if I'm not mistaken, is black. This part out here and the end bells. Of course, this is hidden out here by the dome, but the motor itself is black. I think it was probably that Japan black they used to use. And the rest of it green. So I'm going to go back with that color scheme. Now this rotor is really a work of art. Solid copper and brass for the squirrel cage winding. This part is cast iron. This is steel laminations. And what I don't understand about it, it looks like there's lead put inside there. Not sure if that's balancing or if that's how it was actually bonded together, but that thing is heavy. I would wager that probably weighs 75, maybe 100 pounds. It's shockingly heavy, almost heavier than solid iron. I don't know if ILG discovered a depleted uranium rotor worked pretty well back then or what the story is, but it's got some heft to it. Got it all cleaned up and ready to go back in. Got the inside of the end bells painted. Once again, I'm doing the inside stuff before I put the motor together, but then after it's together, I'm going to tape off the parts I don't want painted and hit the outside. And that will help me to get it together quicker and do a good job in the end. Well, I got a chance to practice my carpentry skills a little bit. I built a box around this thing, and it really is tall. I'm 6 feet tall, and I'm holding this at eye level. And just like me, you guys are seeing the inside of the top. So, I mean, this is a good 5 foot 6 inches at least, counting the caster wheels. I got the green paint, closest I could get to the original, and I've painted it. And I left this motor part unpainted because I got to do a little more cleaning on that. And everything that's near the box is painted already, so I won't get paint on my wood. Use the little hoist to for the strap around here to handle it. And so after I mounted it into the box on the sides before the top panel went on, I painted that part. And now I'm going to move on to figuring out how I'm going to assemble it. One little bad design. This was the original conduit port, and when the motor's in here, you can't get to it. And to make this look better, what I think I'm going to do is route the cables through the cooling air tube and just remove that and only have everything through there. Because you'll have to excuse the mess on the floor down here. When this fan was running at its full speed, it would have a higher pressure zone on this side than on the inside because there was a building wall here and it was drawing air out of the building. And because of the higher pressure out here, air would go through this pipe and cool the motor and come out this way. But I'm going to be running it at a low speed, so I'm going to put a little blower here to force air through there, so no matter how slow I run the main motor, it's still going to be cooled. And the cables can come through here. Probably going to build a little wooden box down here to hide all that, since it won't look period correct. And another really neat thing, I don't have it here yet, but I'm going to have the power transformer down here. And I got one that's from approximately the 40s or 50s. It really looks cool. It'll step the 120-volt domestic power up to 460 for this fan motor. And that I'm going to leave exposed where you can see it. And then probably on the other side over here, I'm going to put a piece of plywood like this to kind of box in the corner and put the VFD in there where you won't see that. So all the period correct stuff I want to be visible, but the stuff that's more modern, I'm going to hide it, try to make it look a little neater. I still haven't figured out a control panel yet. Obviously, it won't be on the top, or you can't reach it somewhere here on the side. Try to search for some older switches and what have you. And the VFD that I've got has an analog function. In other words, there can be a just a knob to turn to adjust the speed. So I'll get some kind of a early looking Bakelite knob and use that to control it. Now I just put the motor dome on there, and by my design, it does stick out beyond the back of the fan. And the grill I'm going to put back here, I plan to make it out of cowl paneling. And if y'all don't understand what that is, just Google it. But it's like a really wide screen. You could reach your arm through the holes, but the material is three sixteenths steel rod, so it's really tough. I'll cut a round hole in that and put a steel trim ring in it that'll fit around this motor. So coming up to it, you'll have the steel mesh cover with a round trim ring in the back of this motor dome visible, which I think that'll look pretty cool. But I hate to cover up that motor because this looks badass like it is, but I also like the dome. Got the rotor ready to go. Got to paint the motor. Well, slowly but surely getting this motor put back together. I got the new lower bearing in and Timken bearing, you know. Set the rotor in there. Run smoothly. Of course, it'll bump because it doesn't have the top cover. Now time to put the top cover on there. Okay, now it's time for the front bearing. The way this end housing is designed, the bearings have to go in afterwards. You can't pre-install them on the rotor shaft. So I will put that in there and go get a driver tool. It'll tap it down. And then once it's down, put this retainer. And once the motor's back in the housing, I'm going to touch up all the paint on it. But I wanted to get the majority of the painting done ahead of time. Get the bearing driven in and come back. All right, now that bearing's in. Got two bearings now. That turns smoothly. Of course, with a 70-pound rotor, you expect it to turn for quite a while. Now just put this retainer on that will hold everything in place. And then it'll be time to figure out how I'm going to get this bad boy back in that frame, because I tell you what, it's heavy. It is very heavy. Well, I'm getting ready to put the little, I don't know what you call that, but goes around the lead wires. It looks pretty ragged. So I cut a piece of a GM car fan shroud, which appears to be similar material. And I'm going to drill that, make a new one. And then get this cover on there and then solder some extended wires on there. And maybe we make a solo test run with this motor. Well, this looks a little bit better compared to that. Now we'll get it put on there and take a look at it with it installed. There we go. Got a new wire plate on there. You can definitely see a difference. That was so warped compared to that one. I wish it would lay completely flat in there, but just the design of the casting, it's not completely flat underneath it. But hey, it's good enough for me. Now get these wires extended where they'll reach down in here where I can terminate them in this junction box. Okay, so motor wiring is spliced and insulated. I put this little clamp on here to help take the strain off of that. And I've got a capacitor hooked up for starting purposes. And this motor is fixing to be started, probably for the first time in a really long time. Okay, now I've got the camera set on the motor, and I'm going to plug it in. If it starts running, you'll hear the sound of the motor change, because I'm going to disconnect that start capacitor once it's running, assuming it starts. So here we go. Capacitor off. You hear it get quieter. And it's running. Well, it runs nice and slow. See the rotor in there turning. loaded RPM 490, so I figure right now without load it's probably running closer to synchronous speed, so about 500 RPM. That doesn't look like much, but when you consider that 48 inch fan blade will be turning that fast, the end of that fan blade, the tip of the fan blade, is going to have pretty good velocity behind it. Now, once again, this is a three-phase motor, so, and it's running at 120 volts right now with the motor configured for 220. So when it gets full voltage three-phase power, the startup torque would be just immense. Probably less than one revolution it would be up to speed without the fan blade on it. With the fan blade, I don't know how quickly it would get up to speed, but it would be damn impressive. Unfortunately, I haven't used my phase converter in a really long time and something happened to it. I don't know if mice got in it or what, so I won't be able to do a three-phase start. And I'm sorry about that. So maybe someday in the near future I'll get that taken care of and we'll be able to do a three-phase start on it. So she's a-running. Move on to the next stage in the restoration process, which will be painting all these little odds and ends that I didn't paint at first, touch-up paint, and then continue with assembly. Well, now that the motor seems to be working, I got to focus on restoring. Well, that is a partially primed fan blade. And I say partially primed because I ran out of primer, so that's it for today. I did get the motor dome taken care of, primed and painted. And of course, y'all saw this earlier, so I will be getting some more paint tomorrow and also going to be checking out my rotary phase converter, see if I might be able to get it going and make a full power function test of this thing before I have to put it away and go back to work. So that's it for today. Thanks for watching.